Mary. Hello, Mary. Those are Mary.
But it's difficult advice if they can't pick up the mic, who would we hear, and things will come from that.
Yeah, and as I said, it's a bit of a frustrated journey to be in.
I like to show off.
I want to talk about the different aspects of your life, but maybe not necessarily chronologically.
Okay, well, that's because that's kind of boring. Yeah, well, and then I was 22.
Well, that leads me to what is an impertinent question, but I know you've answered it before. What are you?
I'm 76, since the 31st of May.
Oh,
well, wow. It would be if I was 24, 25, looking for a better or something. But
that's 3/4 of a century.
Yeah, it is.
That's a very good
one. 3 score and 10, the Lord said, we live, and I'm 6 years over.
And apart from your family, and you now have 6 grandchildren, apart from your family, what was the highlight of that?
I suppose survivor, really, and I'm not being smart. I think when I wake up every day and I put my feet on the ground and I say to myself, thank God I passed the night and thank God I can get up and be in my sound mind and fairly sound health when many people aren't. So I guess to have lived through.
You've actually had a very good friend on there.
I have, yes, thank God again, yes. Mm-hmm. But that's an act of God, it's not, and maybe the genes that you're born into or with.
Do you have religion?
Sort of, yeah. I try and get back.
You're more of it now than you did.
I'm more of it now because I know the end is coming.
No, there's another 20 years in you.
Well, we don't know that, but I do know that the older you get, the nearer comes the judgment day. So I'd be more particular now about not missing Mass. I would try every Sunday, but there's the odd Sunday. I cannot get it. But I pray in my own way. I don't feel on my knees because I've got bad knee. So I don't, but I pray. I pray out loud. I have great devotion to the memorare prayer.
Yeah.
I love it.
Do you think he or she God would be happy with it?
I don't know. I don't know how they take into account, you see. Do they take into account all the nasty things you did? And politics can be pretty nasty.
Yeah.
Or do they take into account some kind of along the way, good things you might have done. Maybe I try to say God is good, he doesn't go out to punish people. He doesn't go out to say, I see you won't get to heaven. I think he goes out to say, I see you, I'll get you into heaven. Yeah. And I think he's a good person.
And again, looking across the material, people use a whole different range of adjectives to describe you. And some of the audience will know I wasn't being called for a while. And a lot of different adjectives.
I bet you did. And I heard adjectives about you.
Me
too.
As well. Some of them are complimentary.
Yeah.
The obvious and easy one sometimes people use is the middle name of Mary.
Or Mammy.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mary McAleese, who launched your book,
yeah,
described you as a radiant.
She did, yeah.
Father and warm.
Yeah.
Maybe she suggested over him.
No, I don't
think
it's over him.
Why did you even describe yourself?
Well, I don't suffer fools, sadly. I suppose I'd be, well, in younger days, I would have been intolerant enough about people whom I knew were false or were carrying on. You know, the worst thing in life is people who pretend to be what they're not. You know, they act as if they're very well born or bred or harsh or loads of money or all those things. Putting on, acting on, I feel that in any way. And I never had any time for it.
So it must have made it very hard in politics.
Pretty hard.
One of the hardest moments I think you described in politics was when you were having an instant education, then for a week while you were in instant education.
For 3 months, yeah.
3 months. Then Charlie Hoddy lost power and Albert ran out of favor.
Yes.
And there was some speculation that Albert would attack some of his ministers.
Sat 13.
Yeah, but you didn't originally feature the speculation.
No, I didn't.
You were surprised when you called to his office.
Well, I wasn't because just the day before that, it had been mooted in one of the newspapers that John was going to make a new minister for health. So I had a bit of an
apprehension.
Yeah, I had.
And how did that meeting go?
The meeting, oh yeah, that was interesting. Now, as I say, now from the hindsight of my mid-70s, he had every right to sack 14 ministers. He wants to have a clean room, a new room, and the way of getting a new room was getting new faces, new names, so that they would resonate with people. Now I see that very easy. Of course, I didn't see it then.
But you told him it was happy at the time that he was curious.
Oh, well, of course, you don't expect him to jump for joy when he said that. Now, I wouldn't be that far seeing.
But he said you were very upset.
He took us all in one by one, he did, and I was the last.
Yeah.
Which was really cruel, I can tell you, because I thought maybe he's not going to thank me, do you know what I mean? So we all came out with, oh, with our faces on them, and I hopped in. And he said, I'm letting you go. So this is all the way of telling you exactly. And I said, oh, why? What complaint have you about me? I was into labor law and all that kind of thing. I said, what complaint have you about me? I don't be talking silly, he said, don't be talking silly. I've no complaint about you, it's just that wow. And he was eating a sandwich, and he was talking. And now, those of you who have read my book, it's in the book, but anyway, he never remembered what his dear mother had told him, don't talk when your mouth is full. So the sandwich came out and out, and Bluffered everywhere, and he's Bluffered, and I went out. That was it.
And you went home, ultimately,
I battered the pillow.
And that's what you described as a fat gin.
A fat gin, double gin? Fat gin. Yeah.
And that kind of marked almost the end. You could have feared then that it might have marked the end of the
No, I never thought that. No, I didn't.
Because you had contested the leadership of King Paul against Albert Hernandez a few weeks before that.
Yeah, I got a little bit of
6 weeks.
One more than my new
brother
in the moment, let's not forget them. Listen, all those things are part of life. You put them behind you, you know, you do and you go on. I was listening on the radio coming down to Ted Kennedy's son, Ted Kennedy Oak, I suppose, and he was talking and saying that, you know, his father, when such a terrible thing happened to his life, that he used to say to his family, look, terrible things happen to you. It's how you learn from them and come out of them. That's what really matters. So I suppose it's the same in politics.
You go back then to kind of the start of your career. I get the impression your dad had an unsolicited attitude to the role of women in the education of the
world. Yeah, I think, I mean, he never...
I get the sense from reading the book that it was your dad who was kind of inspiring you.
Well, it was, but never in a... He said, you should think about it. He never talked like that to me. No, he didn't. But he was very much for women being educated and getting every chance in life if they could. He was very, very keen on that, because later on, I came home and I had my BA and I didn't do a HD because my father was running a hotel, the Hudson Bay Hotel. Some of you might know it if you were ever up around the Midlands, or you don't want to be the lovely county of Wexford, I think. But he... actually, when you come home, and because of at that stage, I was going to do a year, you do many of these as an add-on 1 year after a VA. And then, but he said, my sister, who had been trained at the hotel, she was 4 years older than me, she had gone off and got married. And he said, I'd like to come home and help your mother and myself in the hotel. But he always felt absolutely stopped from getting further education.
Yeah.
And later on, he came to me and said, Maynooth has opened up to do an HD. The first time they let in people who weren't would be priests, and you know, by priests. And then he said, would you go to the meeting and do your HD? And it was marvelous if he wanted me to get more information, to get more educated. As most parents now are wanting their young people to go to third level and to get degrees. But at that time, no, but he was very keen on further education.
Yeah, you were unusual in a sense in that you came to local politics first.
I did, yes, I was in my 40s. No, 30, sorry, mid-30s.
And yeah, I think the chapter was 12 and 16 at the time.
But when I went into national politics, yes, yeah. That's right.
So you were local politics first.
Before that, yes.
By the time you went into national politics, you were further 16.
I think it was 12, yes.
And has that shaped your attitude to making the way for women?
Well, I really think it's difficult for women in who live outside of Dublin, who live away down the country, say in Westford, or in Asco, or Galway, far down again. Because if you have children, no matter what age they are, if there are children at home and they're in education, you worry constantly. I'm endlessly worried. Are they getting on all right? Maybe I'm deprived them of a valuable segment of their lives when they wouldn't have had a mother to advise them or to be beside them. And no, I'm not putting it from you. I can remember the active worry in my head. What will happen to Barton? What will happen to Amy? And now I'm a great husband. Andrew was the best guy in the world. And he was well prepared to do mom and dad for the week until I came home, and then he was reverted to dad. But, and I would be the mom. But I constantly worried, and I do sometimes when I read in the paper such and such a one and climbed up the corporate ladder and she's the managing director of something, and I say to myself, oh, I hope you get over your angst, and it says two small children. Now, I was lucky.
You think, again, the angst is almost inevitable?
It is inevitable. If you're away from home 3-4 days a week, it has to be inevitable.
How did you do it?
Oh, really warm all the time. That's how I dealt with it. And constantly worrying and laying out stuff at home for them and anticipating what they might be going to, what might be coming up. But it is difficult. I often used to think, in the first years I went into the door, you'd get your clothes ready for home, you pick up your hangers in the car and all that. And I used to see the guy standing up to the door, three clean shirts, three ties on, away they go, all worries left behind them. Now that is the truth. They usually had a very good partner or a very good wife or somebody that would mind the homestead. It is difficult. It is difficult. Well, Craig, I've given out about it. I know,
but do you miss some of the
chances? I do. Yes, I do. Yeah, I used to get, well, all boys or girls, 30, 40, they've all the angst that they go through, the worries of puberty and the worries of, you know, every young fellow wants to be the same as the guy in the class who wants to be as good as the mate. And did I lose out on confidences? Now, having said all that, it turned out okay. I have good news for every walking woman in the room. they turned out okay. Grand. And they're both lying now with children. So, something went right. Yeah.
You met him when you were 18.
18,
when
yeah.
You were 22. Mm-hmm. You were your parents, for your parents.
You see, when I got married, I was 1960, which was 53 years ago. Now, Andrew Fleming is dead, but 53 years ago, 22, and Andrew was 24. It was regarded as childish age to get married. Well, Stevie, pretty young. Yeah, almost, yeah. But yeah, I wanted to get married. I desperately wanted to marry Andrew.
Why?
Because I loved him. I loved him. Yeah, I did. I loved him in a physical sense. It was that attracted me first, Lord. And I'm never ashamed to say it. I loved his looks. I loved his physicality. I liked all that about him. He's very good looking. He's very dark, very swarthy, and good looking, and attractive. And I fell for that. I really do. And you know, I kept that in my heart always. I always liked that part of marriage. I thought I was so lucky to have met a man who loved me and who might love that.
You bought a house, or built a house.
We built a house.
53 years ago, and placed that door.
Yeah.
I'm still in
it. I'm still in it. Two.
Built up around
two extensions. One up and one out. You know, as we got on a bit of the children, we had one room and one sink. I mean, I know that sounds strange now when everyone has an adjoining bathroom and an adjoining shower. They're just worth those things. I got married. No, I didn't want them. I was quite happy. But time came on and the boys got bigger, and it was ended. The two boys and myself trying to go to the one room every morning at the one time, or trying to go to the one sink at the one time. And so we built on. We built on. The first extension was a big living room and bedroom for ourselves. And then we built up into the attic when the two children came home with children. And we needed more room. So that's what I'm still in the house I was into. Yes, I love the neighbourhood.
And you've written about how after you got married, you struggled having kids.
Oh, yes, I did, very much.
You got the phone yourself when I got married.
Yeah, somebody said to me, there's a very good gynecologist in Dublin called Dr. Amy De Valera. Now, he would have been the son of the De Valera of the state and all that. And I said, I'm going to where you did if you so would. I remember a neighbor saying to me, do you have to go to a Peter Falk Catholic College? I actually didn't. I only wanted to go to a good one. And so I did. I rang and I got through to the secretary and we made the appointment. But you see, I think that when you get married, well, certainly when I got married, when we got married, Emily and I, it was a case of, I had a baby in 9 months, we thought, because I had two brothers and sister who all married 2 years ahead of me, and they all had baby one, baby two, and were expected baby three. That's Brian Sr. and my brother Paddy, both, God rest them, and my sister Anne and I. They all had children at will of the hop. And I thought it was going to be the same for me. I suppose it was the first sort of a setback in my life, if you like, you know.
Yeah,
and that didn't turn out then. And suddenly, when I say this, it's not for that, so it's to explain that it wasn't for lack of trying. No, seriously, and all that had worked out very satisfactorily, but no, that failed. I didn't get
it. And Dr. Bellaire, Mrs. Bellaire's advice was relax a bit.
Yeah, he said to me, I also remember he was a kindly man. I suppose he was listening to pet up women all the time. And put it up on his couch or whatever, and he did a first probing, and then he said, now I think I'm quite sure you will become pregnant. He said, you know what he did? He instilled a great sense of ease in me. You know, I thought to myself, I remember taking a taxi from the railway station up to Dublin, up to the room, and coming home in another taxi, and saying to myself, now he was so good, he said, I'm quite sure. You see, I was really young, 22, I was now 25, 26. So it wasn't that I was going beyond the hill or over the hill or whatever. I'm quite sure, he said, you will become pregnant. So now you shouldn't worry and you should relax and all that. And I did go home very kind of tranquilized from him. I suppose that was part of his medical skill, really. Yeah.
And you had a child of
I had a child. I was pregnant with him 6 months after that, yeah. So he had a magic touch on
him.
But anyway, yeah, I did become pregnant and never became pregnant again. So it's amazing, isn't it? Like, you often wonder when you look at small families and big families. No, and again, it wasn't for lack of trying. Again, I thought I had discovered a key. That once I unlocked the key, which produced Barbara O'Rourke, that I no bother writing, and I'd have another one, no bother, nothing happened again.
And you made the decision to adopt.
Yeah, well, I went back to Dr. Jemmerly now, and I would say he was a wily bird, didn't bother, I suppose, and he said to me, I think he knew more than he'd get on to me, really, because he said, quite immediately when I went back to him, he went to do my regular share of working, and then he said, have you thought of adoption? And I said we had, but then and I had talked about it. And he said, well, you should think about it, I think. And perhaps he knew maybe more medically about it than he had told me the first day, and he wanted to encourage me. I think he possibly knew, maybe I wasn't mad for a child or whatever, but he said, we can think of adoption. So I went home and told him to call. And then he said, yes, we will. So I rang him up then, and I telephoned him. And I said, yes, we would think about it. And he said, well, I'll be in touch with you.
And
then we adopted Amy. At 5 days old. And you know, when I saw him, he could have come out of me. I always think that he was so young. He was as if I had had him. And he was beautiful. I can see him yet. And he's still lovely and 41 or 42. He had a perfectly good face. And then his dark hair. And I looked at him and I said, your mind, he was lovely. And I felt, because he was so young, that I somehow, he was meant for me. I don't want to tell him very young now, but he was meant for me.
And that was part of your answer to the
Yeah. And then I was quite happy. I was quite happy that I had two sons. I didn't want, you know, I just think sometimes in a one-child family, maybe they have to live up to a lot and maybe they need to. I don't know, but anyway, I had two sons. And I always said adopted the people out there. I adopted the man one child came into them and one child came out of them. And that's the way it was. And they're awful, dear to me, one and the other. In fact, you never think of it now. Just don't think of it. And you know it.
I know the truth. Yeah, I didn't mean, realize anything was up until you said it. But I said that was in part perhaps the angst you had when you, as a mother.
Maybe I felt I was out of him in particular, and that I owed it to him more than his father.
But did you, when you wanted to go into national politics, you just love it?
Oh, I love it. And I still do. Now, I'm not active now, but I would follow every debate, I would follow every cover radio and the television and meet political people. And Sean Connick is here today, and he's not for a friend. And I was just happy to meet them because he was a great friend of mine when I was in the door over the last few years. So anything about politics did interest me.
And was it that put me to know your brother Brian was to you?
He was, yeah.
And your dad had been for a term.
That's right.
For one term, it could be after Brian had
passed. Yeah, but that was only kind of the way life turned out. Because for years and years, my father had been the town councillor, the county councillor, and the town chairman, and he had been Mr. Peter Potter, you know all the towns and people who are involved in politics, and he was very much involved in that.
But you were in the Westmead side, played about over for a while.
Yes,
In Battersea, there, and you were back.
But I went for two conventions now, before. I went for three conventions. People say, oh, you walked into your father's name. Oh, no, I did. My father died in 1970, and it was 1982 when I got into the law. So there was no such thing as walking into it, just a vacant. Oh no, there wasn't. The people often have funny ideas about you. They think that you walked into the door. I went to three conventions. I always tell this to people who are maybe fighting to do something or get somewhere. I say to them, don't give up. I went to convention after convention, and they kept returning a very nice man, but he didn't have a chance of getting a seat. I knew he would never get. And I kept saying to the delegates, please let me go forward and I get a seat. So finally, they did. And I got it.
And you were like, and then Charlie Hockey rang you one day.
That's very funny. You know, I often say when I'm speaking to people, people can take on you, Charlie Hockey. I know that quite well. And I know all that came out. But I retained in my mind, he gave me my first main political chance. And you know the way we are in Ireland, if someone gives you a chance in life, you kind of think that bit better of them. So he rang one day. I was about a month in the door. I was a rookie. So that's what you are when you're in the door. I was a rookie and was a Sunday. And we were at home end of myself, the two lads had gone out. One went in football, one was rowing. And they were gone out and I was preparing the lunch for the dinner or whatever. And then the rookie into the paper. And we had that marvel into the extension from the hall telephone to the kitchen telephone. My whole life, the tablets and the whole thing, that was a big, big loss there. So the phone went and I picked it up and I heard, hello, is that you, there you are? And I said, yes, Charlie Hoyle. Hello, Mr. Hobby, because we were very polite then, we called people by the proper title. And I heard a couple of years, he was over in the paper, and he said, I'll watch you up in the morning for 11 a.m. This is a Sunday night. Because I'm going to appoint you Shadow Minister for Women's Affairs. Now, I know those who have read my book and I met a good part of the other side. I said, no, thank you, I don't want that job. Now, imagine me, I'm holding door there to Charlie Hardy. Well, kind of like doing this for me, I saw in the room. And he said, oh, picky, aren't you? Shadow Minister for Education. geology. No, nature. And that set me on my path. So that's why up here, I'm very department for charity.
So you will come back to China and say?
Oh, no.
You were opposition spokesperson.
And geology was the minister, yeah.
Got into the brief.
We did. Oh, yeah, I loved it. I had been a teacher, not that that would make you the best opposition.
You got stuck into
Harvard. We did, yeah. Well, we got very well, on very well. We never insulted one another. And we often talked about that since that time. We never went in. They seem to get very personal now. I noticed that in the door. They seem to pick up on some awful adjective to shout at somebody. We didn't do shouting. We did do very acute personal criticism of our grief in education. But we didn't do shout out. We didn't do personal good guys. I think they're very, very awful to people. Because it's a big catch up way there. But anyway, we didn't do that. No.
I think you got a tip off then that Perry
we were told that. In advance, yes. By a subservient.
You were. You were considered a bit political at the time.
Yes, we did. Yes, we did.
And then you became Minister.
And then I had to eat my words. I can tell you all, eat humble pie. And when I read Rory, poor Rory Quinn now saying he's going to increase, he's going to have to increase the pupil teacher ratio in primary school by 2 to 1 in 28, now he's going to have to make it 30. I say, oh Rory, I've been there in my mind, yeah. Because we can eat. Ray McSherry was Minister for Finance. Remember that? Macronite, they called it. Because he did cut everything. He said, we have to do more than now. It's for very difficult. And education and health were the two portfolios that were chosen because they were huge spenders and they were picked to be the ones that were going to be knocked back. I always say to Rory, whenever I need to answer that, I only, my bacon was saved simply because health was so serious, because health and all the costs of certain people are waiting. That education, putting more children in the classroom, didn't seem a dreadful thing to do. It is, of course, because you would wish you could have 12 to 1 ratio. But, I had to eat humble pie, eat my words and bring in lots of very difficult things. Yes, I had.
Well, what's the best thing you did?
Yes, when I'm writing the book, I have to think about that. And I suppose I set up the NCCA, the National Council for Curriculum and Assessment, which lays out the programme of subjects for junior cert. I set up a junior, there was no junior cert. It was called...
It would be a junior cert, I think.
No, there was. It was after 20 years, yes, it was that. There was an inter cert and there was a group cert. And if you went to a vocational school, you did a group cert. If you went to what are called mainstream secondary school, you did an inter cert. We combined those two and made it a junior cert, which was quite an innovation. And I set up two new universities by law. The first one is under an Irish government, the other ones have been under an English government, or under the best equality, but we set up Dublin City University and the University of Limerick by legislation. I got a great kick out of that.
Okay, what is it?
Oh, loads of them. Loads of them. Loads of them. But can you see that? What?
I
just got the AGS, I did. You're dead right, I did. If the only one who checked me was that person, I did nothing to him. But mistakes about policy mistakes, you know what I have to do. Running mistakes,
It must be, it was a factor, a feature of education, then a feature of education. What was your attitude then and now to the world of structure?
Yes, well, it never was. It never was an issue. I want to use you now, because he has come up a lot since Rory Quinn, and I am a friend of Rory Quinn's. I think, you know this thing of where people pay fees if they want to, I don't know if there's a fee they do, but in Dublin there are, in Ireland, there are 55 fee paying schools, where if you want to, you can, if you have the money, and if you want to spend your money that way, you can send your son or daughter to a fee-paying school. Now, the Labour Party wants to do away with it, but in fact, there'll be no savings, because if you're of school-going age, you have to be taught that all the land has to be paid. If you're under 16, they have to pay for your school in the state. All of us, everyone, has to pay for your education. And if you can choose Yorkshire, Greece or somewhere, and if they want to spend their money the old way of sending their child to Dorky or to Kilimey or to Top Rose Wood or to Castleknock, you know, try to spend their money if they want to spend it that way. I can't understand.
But they're not buying an advantage in education.
Well, first advantage is it. They've spent their own money. The public system is very good in Ireland. Yeah. If you go to any town, there's a school here, Corey, community school. One of the biggest schools in Ireland, I remember being at the Corey Headford. That school has, I would think, an education equal to Galway, not better. It's different in the UK because the public school is very superior to the free-paid schools, whereas they're not here.
Could you give me that answer on the free-paid schools and answer to a broader question?
Mm-hmm.
What's your assessment of the role of the church?
Yes, because I'm good. It never came up in my time. The parish priest was lucky, when you were lucky, that the board of management was chaired by usually either the rector if it was the Church of Ireland or the priest if it was a Catholic school, and they ran the board of management and in turn they ran the school. Now I think we were very lucky to have that system. We were. Now there's much more an emphasis on freedom of thought for a child. I'm on the National Board of Education together, and I'm very happy and very proud to have been invited. And I can see that the system, and I'm sure you're all aware of Educate Together School in County Wexford, the system of Educate Together is very good because there isn't any one religion taught. The children are encouraged to have freedom of thought about, and to have their parents with them then to plot their way forward in life. I think it's a very good system of education. But I think the church, I heard Jeremy Martin one day on the radio, and he was saying he'd be quite happy to divest the church of schools and to give them to other patrons like Educate Together or like maybe the freestanding parental group.
You think that's a good thing?
I do. I think choice is good. The same way that's how choice is good in the female. I think choice is a good thing if you can have it, but often an area is so combined that the local primary school is a local primary school, and by and large, we have a most marvelous. I was a secondary teacher one time, but my nemesis today is a primary teacher of Ireland. You think of them. They get your child, your darling son or daughter, age 4. They're only a babble, really. They really are a very young child. And they take them and they teach them and they love them and they mold them. There's a marvelous system of primary teaching in Ireland and of secondary of teaching. But the primary teachers are to be so admired. So the local primary school is very, very good. If it is father to get a question with the chairman at the board, so he's doing his very best job.
When I'm talking about Charlie Hobby, and I know a lot came out, but you have a fondness for him because he gave you your first.
Well, he gave me a break, and I think.
But isn't that overlooking the fact that an awful lot?
Of course it. And you know, reporters, and I'm sure there's reporters here, but he used to say sometimes to us, why don't you ask him in Catholic who's clearly got his money? Now, listen, folks, I say to you, we're all around the table, right? 40 men, one woman, I've got a bag.
But did you not sense there was something strange about it?
We all thought, and I heard Cora Owen, actually, there was a documentary, two-part Google called Lately, and I saw Cora Owen, and the presenter asked her, and did you think there was something? She was from North County Dublin as well, and she is from North County Dublin. And he said to her, did you think there was something odd about where Charlie Hobby got his money? And she said, no, we all thought he sold land. That was the thing that kind of myth that grew up, that he had sold land, I think, but that somehow led to his untold wealth. He now knows different.
And now that we know different, do you admire him? Do you respect him? Do you?
Well,
what's your assessment?
Well, my assessment of him was that he did, in his own way, leaving out the bad things, he was a good leader for our country. And that he was able to go to Europe. We had the presidency of Europe at that time, one of those times that he was teaching. And the way, the respect he got in Europe when he led us into Europe, I don't think he took us to Georgia, that was much of a journey, but the way he conducted himself in Europe, and the way he led his country out of difficulties when Raymond Cherry became Minister for Finance and he was issued. So there's no point in saying blank sheet, all black, all bad. We are all made up of good and bad in life. And for him, I'm not yet, he's not long enough gone. In historical perspective, we have not yet got the decent historical perspective of Vichy. Will he turn out to be one of the better ones? Will he turn out to be one of the worst ones? I cannot tell you yet in an historical sense, because that historian will judge that. But I just have that in the top. And of course, we all know then in the end of the journey what happened. But I just take a view of life. I really do think that there's good and bad in every one of us.
Among the bad, among the bad, as you may have seen it, he gave it was the way he dealt with your brother Brian when he was the presidential election candidate in 1990. And do you still, are you still angry or hurt about that?
Oh yeah. But I wrote my book, very funny writing book, because you confront yourself with all, you have to confront yourself. And when I was writing about things in my book, I was brought up very short several times. That was one of them that gave me awful anguish, and I sat down on the couch and I thought about Brian and I thought about that time, and you know, if you, I just had to walk off and get up out of it, because you do, the past comes back and you confront yourself. And yes, he did greet Brian. Brian would be not a friend, he wasn't a personal friend, but he was a very good colleague of Charlie Hollins, and always Brian always best of everyone, and he would have deserved it, really. He worked for the country.
But your brother Brian reconciled himself at the Casper despite the Charlie Hollis back into the presidential election.
He did, because he was that nature. Now, You were sharper by nature.
Yes. You were very sharp for explaining the business.
Yes,
it was. Yes. Yes.
Go back across to Shannon, I said.
I don't think you said go back.
I'm not going to be rude.
You never liked Boris Johnson.
No, I think he's very overbearing. Yeah. What? Sorry?
Too many
hours. Yeah, do you remember that interview we'd ever forget? They showed it on really in the years recently. And you just would gobsmack again. He said to somebody in the audience, well, the house in Brussels and Dublin and Castle Bar, and the housekeepers to go with it. Find some time yourself. And it does make you dumb.
You weren't overly fond of Albert?
No, do you know, I made up Brandon Albert, I did. Yeah,
you were from constituency college.
I was, and so we had to make it up. Yeah. We had to kind of work together eventually. And Albert at the moment is done well, as you know. So, but I did make it up, and we soldiered on in Oxford and with me very happily in the end.
And after he had let you go as minister that time, you became a minister for state,
for
Rapid,
the
Rapid,
yes,
and then you were in the Bertie Ahern Minister for Public Enterprise.
Right,
and Bertie Ahern made you deputy leader.
He did.
I'm trying to remember, I know Mary Harney was leader. 19. But you were the first person in that kind of position in the big parties.
That's right.
What did that?
Indeed.
Did that matter to you?
Well, I thought very honoured, yes, very honoured. Because I was told through to people and I was very honoured to be made deputy leader, and I went around the country a lot. It was the time we went into opposition. It was the time of building up the party, and I did a lot of that.
And now, okay, the historical schedule is a little shorter. What do you make of Bertie Ahern's time?